What's holding you up? Let's get on with the show. We can't hang around here all day.
Welcome, foolish mortals. I am your host, Brian Summer. Now, I must warn you, what you are about to see may in fact frighten, delight, and entertain you. As DoomBuggies.com and David Oneal of ExtinctAttractions.com take you to that frightful night in February 2008, when a gathering of legendary Imagineers were brought to join us mortals in celebration of our decrepit, yet beloved, haunted mansion. A night had been planned like no other before. A dark, mysterious, moonlit dinner was to be held in the swamps of the murky Blue Bayou Lagoon, where a panel of esteemed Disney legends enjoyed a meal with our mansion's most loyal of all followers. They bought their tickets for what they thought would be just a meal. But what they got was a spooktacular night that only now we can reveal to you. Now I must caution you again. The events that unfolded this night may not be suitable for the meek or easily upset. So, join me now as we travel back to February 2008, as we begin with a secret gathering of legends at the illustrious Napa Rose restaurant, hosted by our founder, David Oneal.
Wanted to thank everybody for coming out tonight, and thank all the legends for being here, and Bob, and X, and Blaine, and Harriet, and all the supporting people. You know, we did our interviews with Extinct Attractions, and almost 4 or 5 years ago now, we made that Haunted Mansion disc with you all in it. And you guys are all fans of Haunted Mansion, and I know all of you and wanted to bring you out here.
And I just wanted to say that, you know, Bob Gurr, he made the Doom Buggy for the Haunted Mansion, and I'm really happy that he's here tonight. And, of course, we've got X Atencio, who wrote the script for the Haunted Mansion. He kind of took all the different warring factions of different Imagineers' ideas and kind of made them all commingle and coexist together in a way that I'm sure you guys will all agree that's just spectacular. And he also, of course, wrote the Grim Grinning Ghost song. So, X Atencio's here. And, of course, we have our good friend and Disney legend, Harriet Burns. Harriet has created some of the models for the mansion and done a lot of work on the Haunted Mansion. And of course, next to her is none other than Disney sculpting legend, Blaine Gibson. And Blaine, of course, sculpted all of the figures in the mansion as well as countless in Disneyland. So Blaine, welcome to the show. And we have in attendance also our good friend Neil Patrick Harris, a big Disney fan and a friend of ours. And of course our staff writer, Nathan Ike, is here, along with our friend from DoomBuggies.com, Mr. Mayhem himself. And I've got my good friend Dan and our friend Tim and his wife tonight. Oh, and Dan's wife too. Well, we're going to have some cocktails here, and then we'll walk into Disneyland, and we'll discover what truly is planned for this evening.
It's a lot better than the Holiday Inn where we usually are, so this is a good deal. So anyhow, I just wanted to thank everybody again for coming out and supporting us.
When the crypt tombstones quake.
Spooks come out for screaming wake.
Happy haunts materialize
and begin to vocalize.
Grim grinning ghosts come out to socialize. Now don't close your eyes and don't try to hide, or a silly spook may sit by your side, shrouded in a daft disguise. They pretend to terrorize.
Grim grinning ghosts come out to socialize.
Creeps with eerie eyes.
Start to shrink and harmonize.
Grim grinning ghosts come out to socialize. When you hear the knell of a requiem bell,
we're ghostling when the spirits well.
Restless bones etherealize.
Rise of spooks on every side.
Grim grinning ghosts come out to socialize. To socialize.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, you are about to experience a frightfully cheerful swinging wake. Before we can start the show, we'd like to take this opportunity to remind some of our special guests of just a few safety rules. If you happen to be a free-floating, full-torso, vaporous apparition, we ask that you materialize at this time and remain visible throughout the show. Anyone with a remarkable head for materializing the disembodied is requested to keep your head firmly attached to your body and remain seated in your own chair. There is no lap seating and no floating. Those possessing a cadaverous power, which may or may not betray an aura of foreboding, along with expectant mothers and those with neck and back problems, are asked to check in with a cast member for proper seating. And finally, any Class 5 full roaming vapors, guests with a corruptible mortal state, and ghouls, goblins, or specters lacking the capacity for fun and merriment are ordered to cease any and all supernatural activity and return forthwith to your place of origin or the nearest convenient parallel dimension. Thank you. Now, to warm everybody up and get everybody in the mood, I am going to recite the first line of something that everyone here should know by heart. And once I recite that line, I want you to take over. So everybody ready?
When hinges creak in doorless chambers.
Echo.
Keep going. To the haunted mansion. And the laugh? Very nice indeed. We have some guests for you tonight that are going to come up and speak. Let's bring them up. Jeff Baham, ladies and gentlemen.
If you're a moderator for Game Buggies, would you please stand up just for a moment? I want to thank my moderating staff. They really are responsible for putting together the event. I'm really looking forward along with all of you for tonight. You know, we're all patrons of the arts here tonight, and the art of today's popular culture, Disneyland, is a very important part of that art. We're going to celebrate that. I really appreciate all of you coming, and I really appreciate the support for GoodBuggies.com that you've given me over the past 10 years. It's been a labor of love, sometimes easy, sometimes not so much, but it's really something special to have you all here tonight. So, I think that's all I want to say tonight, and I'm going to go back to you.
Thank you very much. And now someone else to bring up that we have much appreciation for, a man that I've been working for quite some time, He's a fun guy to be around, great at parties, and a wonderful dancer. Ladies and gentlemen, the founder and director of the Extinct Attractions Club, Mr. David Oneal.
Hey everybody, thanks for coming out. As you know, we did a Haunted Mansion DVD probably back in 2004, and a lot of you might have bought it, might have seen it, might have bought a bootleg of it somewhere. But I just wanted to say thanks for everyone. I wanted to thank Exitencio and Bob Gurr and Harry Burns and Blaine and everyone else, Alice Davis, who wanted to be here tonight desperately, but she had a surgery today and couldn't be here. But she sends her best. And I also just wanted to say something about a man that's not with us anymore, but he's a guy I got to meet. Brian came with us to that shoot, and it was Thurl Ravenscroft. And he was a sweet man. He was a celestial navigator during the war. Him and his wife met during the war. They were going to live in Cairo and came back to be an actor. And he has a special place for everybody, I think, when you go through the Haunted Mansion. And I just want to, you know, if you have a drink or anything, I don't have one, but give a salute to Thurl Ravenscroft. And that's the Thurl. He's a great guy. And I want to thank everyone for the support you've shown Extinct Attractions. And let's hear it for the Haunted Mansion.
Thank you, Dave. Our first speaker tonight, ladies and gentlemen, has a rather unique history. He is the owner of Randani Productions, a company which was started by his parents, Randy and Dottie Smith. Randani was one of Disneyland's earliest and most successful suppliers of souvenirs, which were actually made in the Smiths' home in Anaheim. These distinctive skulls, tikis, and tombstones, which often would glow in the dark, are highly valued by collectors today. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, please welcome Mr. Jeff Smith.
Hello, everyone. Having a good time?
Yeah.
How many of you own a Randani skull? Okay, the rest of you can leave. I grew up making skulls with my family, and they weren't valuable to us. We only sold them for about 25 cents each. And up until maybe 5 years ago, we used them as targets for guns. And I gave my daughter over here, Ashley, skulls to use to chop her name into the sidewalk. And one day I looked on eBay and I saw one going for about $55 by seller, and I laughed. And I wrote the seller and I said, there's no way you're gonna sell this item for $55. Of course, it went up to about $110. I went through my daughter's toy box and grabbed a skull out of it. I think of the hundreds, maybe even thousands of tombstones that were boxed and I threw away because I didn't sell it anymore. But we started about 1956, 1957 with Disney, and we used to drive our family car, Ford station wagon, down Main Street, had a piece of cardboard we put under it. And one day, I wasn't there, but my mom loved to tell the story. Walt Disney was walking by, and everyone was, you know, good morning, Mr. Disney. Good morning, Mr. Disney, and he would just keep walking on. My mom said, hi, Walt. And he turned around, do I know you? Yeah, I'm one of your sellers here. I sell to the junk shop, and he said, what items? And she said, the skull items. So you're the one that makes those. And he took her out to breakfast, and we had a whole lot of respect from the buyers up until the 1990s. And I have no idea how many skulls we've sold, but over the last year, being with the June Buggies, I find that there's quite a bit of them out there right now. Making the items was a lot of fun. With a mold and rubber bands, and the rubber has oils in it, you have plaster. The problem was that the plaster would go onto the rubber bands, would harden onto it, and then the rubber bands would break, and you have plaster on it. You have a foot-long rubber band, it feels like a cat of nine tails whipping you. I learned to cuss when I was young in that casting department. And then there was the glow department, and I love this part. We'd spray the glow on the skulls. And at nighttime, sometimes you would have to work late at night, turn off the lights. There would be 1,000 skulls in the building. The whole place would glow green. So bright that you could read a book. But the neighbors would start talking. You know, is it radioactive? He mentioned Anaheim. We used to make the molds in Anaheim. And these rubber molds, they would burn and smell. So the neighbors would complain. Well, my dad, being the genius that he was, at least I think he was, he built a secret room. And you'd have to move a picture. So that secret room is where we made the mold. So the city would come by, complaints, you know, and they would come back to the building, and they could never find out where this smell was coming from. So that's pretty much all I have right now. If any of you have any questions, refunds. What?
Can you tell us about the tombstones?
The tombstones. There were a lot of them, but well, I used them as targets. You know, any specific questions? I mean, tell you about the tombstones. I'm sorry. Oh gosh, I put that on the board. I don't know exactly how many. I don't remember how many different styles there were. There were a lot of old ones that we tried selling. Bang bang, like wow. You know, it just wouldn't go. But no, I don't remember. I have the catalog in my bag there, but I don't remember how many there were off the top of my head. I'm a little nervous. I'm not a professional speaker, so. Can you tell?
How much influence did Disney have on the designs versus how much you guys came up with the design?
Well, he's asking how much influence Disney had. They would ask us to make specific items. Surprisingly, they never asked us to make the pre-hitch hypers or anything like that. I was pretty surprised about that. Yeah, they just asked. It got to the point where they would actually lend my father original pieces. And in fact, I did post some pictures on the board recently, doing buggies, with my mom holding some of the Bear Jamboree figures. And those are now on display downtown there in the old Lincoln display. And anytime they just give my dad a picture, an item, and he'd copy it. They actually gave him the elephant model once, and he made, it was actually at our home. You know, and I there's a story about that, but I don't want to get in trouble.
Thank you. Thank you, Dave. Folks, now comes the time when we are going to introduce some people up to this table right here that we have a great deal of thanks to give to. So let me start off by introducing our first special guest. She was the first woman ever hired by WED in a creative capacity rather than a office role. With a background in interior design, she helped design and build models and maquettes for the Haunted Mansion as well as many other attractions. She worked shoulder to shoulder with the men in the model shop. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Disney legend Harriet Burns. Our next special guest, ladies and gentlemen, began his career as an animator for Walt Disney. However, when Walt saw some of his sculptures at an art exhibit, he quickly brought him to WED to help sculpt animals, characters such as the famous hitchhiking ghosts, and special projects for the New York World's Fair and eventually Disneyland. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, please welcome Disney legend Blaine Gibson. Yay. Who could they be? Well, I'm going to tell you. Our next guest was WED's primary transportation designer. having developed more than 100 vehicle designs for everything from Autopia to the Matterhorn bobsleds to the Doom buggies found in the Haunted Mansion, he's also worked on early animatronics and continues to consult on various Disney projects. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome Disney legend Bob Gurr. Gentlemen, our last guest began working for WED as an animator. Though he was tapped by Walt to join WED in 1965, where he worked in the Primeval World diorama and other concept art, including sketches for the Haunted Mansion. He is best known for creating scripts and songs for Disney attractions, including Pirates of the Caribbean and Haunted Mansion. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, please welcome Disney legend, X Atencio. For the legends, if you would grace us with your wisdom. Harriet, we'd like to start with you. Could you please discuss being hired by Walt and what it was like to be one of the first females in the department? Specifically, did you feel any challenges to prove yourself as a female artist in those days?
No, actually.
Nope, mic on.
Can you hear me? No, at that time, everything was so new. This was 1955. The park had not opened yet, and I was hired to do the sets and props for the Mickey Mouse television show. And that was just going to start. And so that was exciting, because a lot of people didn't have television, and a lot of little towns couldn't get reception for the television. So then Walt said, you won't be shooting all the time, and when you're not shooting, you can work on this park that I'm going to work with these art directors. So it just happened, and that's the whole story. I mean, we just worked with the art directors. They happened to be male. It just wasn't anybody female around. And so there was really no problem in any direction at that time, because there was so few in the animation department and the ink and paint department. That was what the studio was built for. So we were just stuck on the back lot as oddball people.
And
so what's one more oddball?
Indeed. When you were developing the scenes and models for the Haunted Mansion, who did you work with most closely? And how did you go about translating ideas into three-dimensional spaces?
Well, Ken Anderson was the head art director when we did it the first time, before it was shelved. And we worked with Ken. Ken would come down to our department. Fred Jerger, Wayfield Rogers, and myself, I don't think there was anyone else at that time, and Ken. And we worked directly with Ken, and then when Walt would change something, well, he would be with us, but I mean, he was part of the team, and that was the wonderful part. And is that what you asked?
Absolutely, thank you very much. Blaine, we'd like to ask you, as the primary WED sculptor, do any particular projects over the years stand out for you? Any favorites?
Well, there's so many of them, I think all of them are the favorites. But some of the bigger challenges, and the first one, I think, was Abraham Lincoln. And the reason it was a big challenge is because Walt really wanted to give the feeling of a real, live, believable guy. And he already had voices worked out and so forth. And so actually, to give me a little bit of a head start on it, I was able to acquire through our props department at Disney Studio a life mask made of bacon. Well, that was, when I say life mask, that's different from a death mask in the sense that he was a young man and it was 1960. And that this was done by a sculptor named Leonard Volk, who was a Chicago sculptor, who ironically was the son-in-law of Lincoln's old adversary, debater, which made it a little bit of a strange tie. But anyway, that was an aid because I could actually take measurements. But I didn't dare copy those exactly because in order to see a figure or anything in any of our shows required some exaggeration and some trying to get a little more of the character that actually was there. And even so, the head did not look large by little additions on the cheeks, little additions in the hollow of the cheeks, and so forth like that. But there were a whole number of things we did, and to pick out one or two of this would be very difficult.
I would think so after all of those wonderful projects. You mentioned exaggeration in the character. Could you tell us how you developed your inspiration for the Haunted Mansion characters? Did you stay true to the designs by Mark Davis and the other Imagineers?
Actually, whenever we're in a territory bordering on cartoon, my main job was to keep them believable. And I definitely respected Mark Davis's ideas and even the poses and things like that were very important. But sometimes on the heads, we would do something so that it had the actual believability of a real skull, even though there may have been exaggerations. Like all of you know, when you started leaving the ride, and you were hitching a ride without knowing it, out of the show in a vehicle, a car, and all of a sudden you've got a partner with you. Well, these guys were still based on Mark's ideas, but they were, in my opinion, an intent on my part to keep them believable, because Walt wanted everything believable, no matter how broad the cartoon was.
Thank you. We're going to move to Bob Gurr now. Bob, the Omnimover system has been compared to in-person cinematography, as it directs the rider's attention to whatever the scene the director wants. Can you talk about some of the challenges you faced early on in the development of the Omnimover system?
Well, we didn't really have any challenges. Some of you may know the Haunted Mansion ride and the Monsanto Adventures to Inner Space. Those rides are kind of blended together in the development period of time. And after the World's Fair, which I did a lot of work on the Magic Skyway, I really liked the General Motors ride because the vehicles were all connected together and they couldn't run into one another like the Ford ride. AT&T had another ride the same way, where it's like an automobile assembly line. So Walt had us start to work on a museum ride for the La Brea Tar Pits, a ride that we never went ahead with, but that was the genesis of what later became the Omnimover ride. And then while we were making drawings of that and discussing it in 1964 with the people down on La Brea Tar Pits, Monsanto wanted to do some kind of a ride, but we'd been working on the Haunted Mansion for a very, very long time. It was going to be a walkthrough. And then I thought, well, maybe it ought to be a ride-through. So one day I was sitting in John Hench's office and talking with him, and he had a candied apple sitting on his desk. And we were just kind of discussing kind of blue sky-like, well, how could you do this, how could you do that? And I said, well, first off, we ought to have a chain of vehicles like a bunch of elephants. You know, each elephant's trunk grabs the tail of the other and they can't crash one another if you do it that way. Next thing was, well, the vehicles would just ride around a track, but what if on top of the vehicle we had a post where we could have a chair for like two people and it could rotate look right, look left, go up, go down. That meant the ride could go up a hill, and then the seat would stay forward. You could go down a hill, the seat would still stay level. And we could ride backwards, sideways, forwards. And then John Hinch looked and said, well, you know, we could look at each scene, kind of a segue of scenes, much better that way. And I picked up the app one, I just kind of twirled it around, and I said, oh, here we go, like this. We'll just do that. And since I was an airplane pilot at the time, and the main navigational aid was called an Omni range, Omni being all or all directional. And I said, well, we're going to move, and then Omni, all directions, so it's an Omni mover. So the Omni mover name came about just like that, in a conversation, trying to describe how you could look at scenes in a much better manner. Well, of course, we got started much quicker on my Monsanto ride. So by the time the Haunted Mansion, all the gags were figured out pretty well, and we were going to go ahead and do that. We already had a ride pretty well working, and we just kind of manufactured one and kept manufacturing the other, and it became the Haunted Mansion.
Inspiration comes from the most interesting places.
Thank you, sir.
Even if you're doing it with a candy apple.
Exactly. Thank you. X, we'd like to ask you to briefly discuss how you went about writing the lyrics for Grim Grinning Ghost, the Haunted Mansion's theme song.
After I finished Pirates of the Caribbean, I decided to the Haunted Mansion. And so I took off my pirate hat, put on my spook hat, and got to work doing the narration for the haunting. And then the success of the UFO song, I said, we got to have another song. And so I did the Grim Grinning Ghost song. And one thing led to another.
And you actually started out as an artist for WED. How did that change come about, where you moved more towards into the scripts and the songwriting?
Walt sent me over to Imaginary and assigned me to do the Pirates of the Caribbean. I'd never done any scripting before, but Walt seemed to understand that I could, and so I did.
I've heard Bob talk about how Walt would put people into projects that they didn't think they necessarily were fitted for, but because Walt put them in that position, they found a way to do it. It was sort of shoving them out of the nest, as it were, into uncharted territory.
Very uncanny in finding talent in these people that we didn't know we had ourselves, as you say. And, I'd never done any scripting. First time I've done it, didn't any songwriting. I did it, and it worked out very, very nice.
So we could almost say that if it wasn't for Walt pushing you in that direction, we wouldn't even know that particular song.
You're right.
Quite the man. Ladies and gentlemen, we have just a little bit of time left. I'd like to try and take maybe two questions from the audience. So if anybody has a question, please raise your hand. Anyone at all? Questions from the audience. We have one in the back. Hold on, folks. We're going back in. Pardon me. Hi, nice to see you. Hi there. Good to see you. How was Denver?
Very good.
Excellent. Here we go. Question from the back row.
Hi, Randy from up in Burbank. I'd actually like to find out what really happened with the Hatbox Ghost. Because I thought about it, and even with 1960s technology, it seems to me that the great Imagineering and WED companies could have gotten around the problem of making his head disappear. And we had this whole wonderful story about the Hatbox, and I'm just curious if any of you know exactly, you know, what went wrong.
Thank you, Randy. The Hatbox Ghost, we've all heard about him. Can any of our legends actually tell us if the Hatbox Ghost was ever actually installed in the mansion?
Out of me.
And it's going to remain a mystery, ladies and gentlemen. There you go. All right, well, you know, that's the wonderful thing about Legends of Disneyland. Who knows? Maybe he was there, maybe he wasn't there. Were we all imagining him? One more question, right here, gentlemen up front.
Ralph from Indiana. Question. What do the Imagineers think of the new Haunted Mansion re-haunting in Florida? Have any of you seen it or heard about it?
The update in Florida? The Florida Haunted Mansion? Have any of you seen it with all of the new effects? Mayhem?
Oh.
So we will, one more question. Anybody else? One more question. We've got time for just one more. Gentleman right there, put his hands straight up in the air. It's going to be a good question. I've got this feeling. Here we go.
Hi, I'm Steve. Specifically for X, I'm just curious if you got the phrase grim grinning ghosts from Shakespeare, because that's something that came up recently on the boards. I think Jeff actually uncovered it.
From Shakespeare, the term grim grinning ghosts, is that from Shakespeare or was that something original from you? The Bard of Glendale, Exitensio. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in showing your appreciation for the Disney Legends. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a representative from DuneBuggies.com that is going to come up. He's going to round this out for us. So if you just remain seated for just a minute, we'll bring Scott up. And here he is right now.
Scott. Usually giving me a microphone and making me the loudest person in the room is a critical mistake. However, since they've done so, just a couple of wrap-up announcements right here. Those of us who have been moderators on Doom Buggies have a great deal of thanks to give to Jeff. I'm assuming that most of you guys here in the room are Haunted Mansion fans. And we probably have more than a few friends, acquaintances, family members, or therapists who take a look at us and go, as one friend said, dude, let me get this straight. You're flying all the way across the country to have dinner with spooky puppets. I looked at him and said, yeah. Dude, you're dysfunctional. It's like, no, we're not obsessed, we are alternatively focused. But I think all of us recognize that without Jeff Baham, we would not be here tonight. We would not have probably such a closely knit network of alternatively focused fans. So Jeff, could you come up here for just a moment, please? Once again, let's hear for Jeff, the greatest, greatest ghost among us. Feel free to open it at your convenience. You're quite welcome. And also, one final thanks to all of the Disney Imagineers who gave us this wonderful work of art that we all nucleated around. So, thank you. We're not worthy. Now, as we all slowly make our way in an organized fashion over to the mansion, after the ride-through is finished, don't just rush out of the park. We have some more fun for you on the way out. So try to congregate in a way near the front.
It'll be near the front.
Okay. Near the front entrance, there will be some more fun. So don't just rush out, because if you do, your stuff's going up on eBay. So, no. And you know, each one of these things that you've got in Tombstone does have a DNA personalized tracking beacon, like the thing they're putting in moose ears on National Geographic. So if it does end up on eBay, the Disney Death Squad will come by and teach you the truncheons. So, once again, I think we're ready for that now to go out to the mansion. All right. We're going to do it by table, or are we just going to... We're going to take votes to the mansion. So. Now, stop playing Deliverance over there. Oh, I guess.
Yeah. Actually, I got to...
talk amongst yourselves for one moment.
I'd say we do a sing-along, but that's probably going to be a bad idea. She wants to sing. You want to sing? No, no, see, you don't write a check, you're not ready to cash. So, I can stand up here and just do imitations.
Can we do another question?
Yeah, we can do another question,
for
I suppose.
What's
your question, sir?
What were the challenges of working on the Haunted Mansion because it happened right after Walt's death?
What were the challenges of working on the Haunted Mansion, the first project that was to be completed after Walt's death? Were there any special difficulties in doing that?
No, you got to remember, when Walt would take a vacation with Lily to Europe and be gone for 2 or 3 weeks, there was so much inertia, we just kept going on everything. So after Walt was not here anymore, many of the things already had its own energy and its own flow, and it just kept running along because we were already in motion. It wasn't until maybe 1970 or so before it was like, oh, Walt's not coming back. What are we going to do next? So the Haunted Mansion was the thing that Walt was really spending a lot of time on, because we mocked up every scene up at Walt Disney Imagineering. Of course, we called it Wet Enterprises in those days. And all of these scenes were already mocked up and worked out in great detail. So it was just a case of everybody just keeps right on going. You know, we missed Walt, but we were on a roll, and we were just going to finish everything and get everything installed here. So the anguish didn't really come until later.
Okay, well, we thank you. And right now, there is a particular dark house at the end of this lane right out there that is awaiting a visit from us. So let us leave in a hurried, disorganized, and dangerous fashion. Please keep all arms and legs outside of the ride. Take as many flash pictures as you want. And no, I'm just kidding about the flash pictures. I know, unfortunately, the Disney guys want to get that. And one final thing, hurry back. Good night.
Hey, Brian, so what's the word here?
Great stuff. Another fine David Oneal. Here you go, Brian. Here's the script. 5 minutes preparation. Get out there and dance like a monkey.
Yeah, hey, good job. Good job.
Yeah, it's
some kind of hard to see in there.
New buggies.
Good job.
Awesome job.
Yeah, I know
how you guys doing?
Real. So it's like I have to stop everybody. It's like there's no mystery in front of Bob.
That's a very good point.
All right.
Thank you.
Sure, I can do that. You gonna do black on black?
That's selfish.
Oh, sure.
So what did you think, Bob?
Excellent, excellent. Finally come to the Blue Bayou after 30 years of waiting for a reservation, and you got me my reservation.
We did. Hey, heading out to the Haunted Mansion.
This is the wallpaper from the Haunted Mansion.
Yeah, and where will that wallpaper be?
In the Haunted Mansion. In
right,
the
and somehow it's pasted on you.
Yeah, by Hannah Atchison.
Wow.
You can see on LA Inc. now, actually. But
wow.
She's a friend of a friend of mine.
We will have to send that to Rolly.
Yeah.
What did you think of the event, X?
I think you did a good job.
Thank you, buddy. Well, we're off to the Haunted Mansion?
Yes, sir.
All right, right this way.
Okay, it's David here, and we're walking over to the Haunted Mansion, and we're going to have a good time.
And here comes X Atencio back home to the Haunted Mansion.
One more? One, two, three.
Okay.
Hey, what's going on over here tonight?
Hey.
How's everything?
Going well.
Going well. What are we? What's everyone lined up here for?
All right.
Good job. Wow. Who do we have here? What's up, Neil?
What's up?
What are you waiting for?
I'm getting my pictures taken with ghosts.
Nice. Good job. How about you, bud?
I'm waiting to dance with the dead.
Nice. And then you?
Gonna hang out with those hitchhiking ghosts, maybe hitchhike with them.
Sweet.
Not me.
You never know who you're gonna see in line for the Haunted Mansion. It's Bob Gurr.
Ah! It's a ghost! It's a ghost! I can see it! It's inside! It's inside! If I look, I die! Ah!
Sometimes the Haunted Mansion, you meet the strangest people.
Yeah, oh, here he is.
It's Nathan.
I'm just holding the strangest person's leash.
Nice.
You went up at it?
Yeah.
Just shoot Iris.
It's all right.
Welcome to the Haunted Mansion.
That was pretty cheesy.
Right this way, Ned. All the way in.
This is my new DVD,
now,
Haunted.
Here's the shot of a lifetime, huh? Right.
This is like Christmas.
Yeah, good
stuff.
Her by herself. There we go. I'm completely alone.
Don't forget to buy the new DVD, Haunted Mansion Alone with Brian Summer.
Yes. Home Alone in the Haunted Mansion.
With Brian Summer.
This time, the hitchhiking ghost thing.
Look at the toys. You ready?
All right.
Oh my gosh, I feel like a celebrity.
You are. You're Nathan Ike.
You're Nathan Ike.
Well, it's Harriet Burns.
Indeed.
How are you? And then Blaine Gibson at the Haunted Mansion.
How are you
there? Fabulous.
Right this way, yes. All the way forward, please.
A little bit of a step here.
Yeah.
Do you want to go there? There you are. I'm going to get a little bit of a step there. There you are, sir.
Summer there, welcoming us into a haunted mansion.
There's no turning back now.
begins here at this gallery, where you see paintings of some of our guests as they appear in their corruptible, mortal state. Your cadaverous pallor betrays an aura of foreboding, almost as though you sense a disquieting metamorphosis. Is this haunted room actually stretching, or is it your imagination? And consider this dismaying observation. This chamber has no windows and no doors. Which offers you this chilling challenge, to find a way out. Of course, there's always my way. Chills come later. Now, as they say, look alive, and we'll continue our little tour. And let's all stay together. Several prominent ghosts who have retired here from creepy old crypts all over the world. Actually, we have 999 happy haunts here, but there's room for 1,000. Any volunteers? If you insist on lagging behind, you may not need to volunteer. The carriage that will carry you into the moldering sanctum of the spirit world will accommodate you and one or two loved ones. Kindly watch your step as you board, please. We spirits haunt our best in gloomy darkness, so remember, no flash pictures, please. Down in the safety bar, please. I will lower it for you. And heed this warning. The spirits will materialize only if you remain safely seated with your hands, arms, feet, and legs inside. And watch your children, please.
Por su seguridad, permanezca sentado y mantenga las manos, brazos, pies y piernas dentro del vehículo. Y cuide a los pequeñitos. Y ahora, prepárese.
We find it delightfully unlivable here in this ghostly retreat. Every room has wall-to-wall creeps. And hot and cold, running chills. Shh. Listen.
Thank you. Safety bar, and the ghost will follow you home. try stepping away from the cars with your left foot first. Step out and stand on the wooden platform.
Be sure to bring your death certificate if you decide to join us. Make final arrangements now. We've been dying to have you.
That was the guy, Joel Green, that found that speaker loop that with the cackling
thing. Oh, really?
When hinges creak in doorless chambers, and strange and frightening sounds echo through the halls, whenever candlelights flicker where the air is deathly still, that is the time when ghosts are present, practicing their terror with ghoulish delight. Your ghost host will be here presently to conduct you on your tour of this sanctuary for the disembodied.
Welcome, foolish mortals. I am your host, your ghost host, the lord and master of this haunted mansion. Inside and outside, and even between the walls of this possessed manor, are ghosts brought here from the darkest tombs of the earth. Heinous but delightful creatures, everyone. All 999 of them. We have room for 1,000. Any volunteers? Your carriage awaits to take you on your little trip through the haunted mansion. I will remain behind and prepare suitable epithets for those of you faint-hearted guests who already are feeling a certain detachment from your mortal being. Bon voyage, as we say, and rest in peace.
I think that probably does it.